Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Health and Wellness Web Talk. I would like to thank all of you for joining this Web Talk on Sundays consistently. And I'm happy to mention we have completed 6 Web Talks successfully, and today is the 7th. And this Web Talk is organized by Chronic Foundation in association with Rotary Bangalore Ratinagar and Rotary Bangalore Yelahanka. Today, the speaker is going to speak on the most important muscle in the body. The moment we say muscle, what comes to our mind is the biceps or triceps. And everyone spends so much time to build those muscles. But one muscle which beats 1 lakh times, sends more than 13,000 liters of blood through 75,000 miles of blood vessels each day. Now, which is this, which is the incredible muscle? Is it the bicep triceps or the blood pumping muscle called heart? So let's spend some time today to understand the health of the cardiovascular system. And today, the speaker is again an incredible speaker, one of the leading minimally invasive cardiac surgeon in the country and gold medalist in MS General Surgery and received MCH Super Speciality degree from All India Institute of Medical Science, Delhi. He has further obtained a fellowship in pediatric and adult cardiac surgery from the University of Alberta Hospital, Strawley Children's Hospital, and Mahi, Edmonton, Canada. He has performed more than 6,000 surgeries in his 15 years of experience in this field. Shocking to know the numbers. I think we haven't shook hand 6,000 people, but he has touched 6,000 hearts. His experience, surgical fields are minimally invasive, cardiac surgery, beating heart, coronary artery bypass surgeries, heart transplantation, complex pediatric cardiac surgery. He has done fellowship and training at Alberta Heart Institute, Canada, observership at International Cardiac Center at USA, Canada, and Europe. He has published 32 publications in international indexed journals. He is a member of Indian Association of Cardiothoracic Surgery, member of Heart Valves Society of America, member of Canadian Cardiovascular Society, member of Western Canadian Heart Network, member of American Association of Thoracic Surgery. He is a head of cardiothoracic and vascular surgeon in Sagar Hospital. So we have with us Dr. Ashwini Kumar Prasad. Sir, welcome you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ramesh.
Sir, we always bother about this wall muscle when it's about to stop pumping. We never even think of its presence when it's functioning. So we want to understand from you, how important is this incredible muscle and how to take care to keep healthy. So over to Dr. Ashwini Kumar Prasad. Friends, please post your questions. Let's make it more interactive. Over to Dr. Ashwini Kumar Prasad.
Well, thank you, Mr. Ramesh, and thank you very much. At the outset, I would like to thank all the Rotary members who made it possible today for this meeting. And right now, I'm going to talk about certain important things, the myths and facts about the heart. Can we go to the slideshow if you want? Okay, thank you. So, next slide, please. As Mr. Ramesh told already about this wonderful heart muscle, how it works, how it pumps, and it is a muscle which will never get tired. You know, it keeps beating for years and years together throughout an average lifespan of 75-80 years. And interestingly, this is the first heart muscle, this is the first muscle to start work when a lady becomes pregnant. At the 4 weeks of pregnancy, this is the first organ which is going to start beating. By 4 weeks, when the lady doesn't know that she is already, she is a pregnant woman, she's already carrying, the heart would have started working. This is the first organ to start working. As you know that the heart has four chambers. The upper two chambers are called atria and the lower two chambers are called ventricle. And there are two valves which will prevent the regurgitation or the backflow of the blood and which will carry the blood in a unidirectional flow called tricuspid valve and the mitral valve. And the two great arteries, one is on the right side which carries the impure blood to the lungs. Another is aorta, which will carry the pure blood to the part of the body. And once this blood carries to the other parts of the body, before carrying to other parts, it will carry the pure blood to itself by a very delicate, small caliber three vessels called coronary arteries. You can see on the slide there, there are three coronary arteries, two on the left side and one on the right side, which will carry the oxygenated blood or the pure blood to its own muscle, to nourish its own muscle, so that it will keep beating constantly and regularly. Next slide, please. So as you know that when we come to the different types of cardiac diseases, So there are three different types of cardiac diseases a man can have. One is congenital heart disease, the heart disease at birth, when the womb is formed, the baby is formed, at that point of time, by 4 weeks, any genetic defect or any problem happens in the development of the heart, we can have congenital heart disease. That is also called as hole in the heart. Many people will tell, my kid had a hole in the heart in the upper chamber, hole in the heart in the lower chamber. Sometimes some chamber of the heart is not developed properly. Sometimes the valves are not developed properly. They are called congenital heart disease. We find this out at the 5th month of pregnancy. When you do a scanning, anomaly scanning, when you see the heart of the baby, you can see if there is any problem, you can pick up those problems. And at the time of birth or immediately after birth, you can treat these kind of heart diseases. Second part is valvular heart disease. Valvular heart disease, usually they come in the younger age group, that is between 15 to 45 years of age group. What happens when the child goes to the school? Most of the time, because of streptococcal throat infection, the school going boy will have tonsillitis, throat infection, pharyngitis by a bacteria called streptococcus. And this bacteria releases a poison called streptoricin, which will go and sit on the heart valves. And slowly these heart valves will keep destroying. And by the age of 30 or 35 years, at this prime age, the heart valves will get either blocked or start leaking. That is coronary heart disease. And the third disease what the heart can have is coronary artery disease. Coronary artery disease is most interesting, and it is an interesting subject topic for most of us because it affects the middle age and nowadays at a younger age as well due to our change of lifestyles. This coronary artery disease happens due to variable and non-variable causes. They develop a plaque and the plaque keeps on increasing, the calcium keeps on increasing, and the deposition increases, the blood gets clotted and patient will have heart attack. So this is also called as heart attack disease. Why I am telling you these things are, most of these heart problems 30 years back, 40 years back were untreatable. They could not be treated. There was a myth that, you know, once you get a heart problem, you are going to die of it. And the heart cannot be touched. It cannot be operated. Nothing we can do. But now, due to the latest advances in technology and the surgical skills, most of these heart problems can be treated and they can lead a normal life. If it is a congenital heart disease, you identify the problem, you operate at the early age, as soon as, you know, a newborn baby also can be operated, heart can be operated. Like that, during childhood, surgeries can be done successfully. During the younger age group, between 15 to 35 years, if there is a valvular heart disease, we can repair these valves or replace these valves with different types of valves, which are artificial valves, which are available, whether it is bioprosthetic valve, the valves from either bovine or porcine, that is from the cow, or artificial valves made up of metals, can replace these damaged valves. And coronary artery disease, as you know, we have a lot of treatment, including very good medications, stents, drug-coated stents, bypass surgeries, minimally invasive heart surgeries. So most of these heart diseases can be treated, can be operated, they can lead a normal life, even though these problems arise. But the point is, it is not important that the treatment is there. It is important that to prevent these heart diseases. How do you prevent these heart diseases? During pregnancy, or when the parents decide to concept, they have to take care of their health. They can have a planned pregnancy. They should not have any diseases at that point of time, should not be on any medications at that point of time. Make sure that pregnancy is carried smoothly without any health issues, so that the child will be healthy. At the same time, when the child goes to the school, you should make sure that this kind of throat infections, as you know that this corona, COVID, you know that droplet infections can happen in the school. Try to keep the child clean in the school, educate the child, and then you can prevent this valvular heart diseases by keeping the environment clean. Coming to coronary artery disease, next slide, please. Can we go? Yeah. These are the coronary arteries that I told you. There are three coronary arteries, one on the right side, another two on the left side. And these coronary arteries will start developing plaquing in certain high-risk patients. And how to prevent those plaquing and how to prevent those heart attack, I'm going to talk about this in the next few slides. Next slide, please. Can you see there the artery lining? There is a smooth intimal line, which is layered with endothelium. It's a small single cell layer. And this single cell layer, if there is a breach in this cell layer, there is deposition of the fat. That is called plaquing. Once this deposition of fat keeps on increasing, there will be saponification and they get calcified, calcification. And once this calcification narrows the vessel more than 70% of its caliber, the blood vessels, the red blood cells get clotted there, and there is no blood supply further to the heart muscle. The heart muscle will start dying. That's how we get a heart attack. Next slide, please. So what is heart attack? The coronary arteries become blocked by usually a clot. The blood flow is closed off and the heart starts struggling to beat, and patient may die. Heart may stop beating. In 70% of the time, by the time a person gets a heart attack and comes to the hospital, he can be saved by treatment. 30% of the time, it may not be possible. Next slide, please. And once this vessel gets blocked, you can see that darkish colored the area in the heart muscle, that area, wherever this blood supplies the blood, the oxygen, that area gets cut off with all the nutrition and oxygen, and the heart muscle will die. That is called heart attack or myocardial infarction. Next slide, please. So what are the presentations? There may be no symptoms at all. There may be a symptom of angina, that is chest pain, or symptom of sudden stoppage of heart. Patient may fall down and they may have sudden cardiac death. Next slide, please. Or patient may have uncomfortable pressure kind of sensation, fullness, squeezing type of pain, pain spreading to the shoulders and necks and arms, chest discomfort, and lightheadedness, anxiety. There might be a nervousness, and then sweating. Next slide, please. So this heart disease can be caused by stress, mental stress, physical stress, overworking, and it is very common in lower socioeconomic group. Initially, we used to think that it is for the upper class. This disease usually happens in upper class, upper society. Now, it is very common in lower socioeconomic groups, and any sudden excitement or shock can cause a flaring up of this heart attack. Next slide, please. So what are the risk factors? There are major risk factors and minor risk factors. Major risk factors are patients with diabetes, patients with high blood pressure, abnormal cholesterol, family history of heart attack, smokers, mental stress and physical stress. They are all major risk factors. They are all prone for heart attack. And minor risk factors are obesity, inactiveness, bad diet, increased uric acid levels, and hormonal disorders. Next slide, please. So what are the changeable risk factors? Hypertension. We can control the hypertension with medicines, exercise, and regular dieting. Reduce the cholesterol. You will reduce the risk of heart attack. If a person is an obese person, you reduce the weight, you can prevent a heart attack. Diabetes, you control the diabetes properly, you can prevent the plaquing in the blood vessels. Physical inactivity, you have to start, you know, stop sitting and start walking and doing exercises. Cigarette smoking, stop cigarette smoking, you can prevent heart attack. Excess alcohol intake also can cause heart attack. A moderate form of alcohol intake can reduce. In some certain studies have shown that heart attack can be reduced with the moderate intake, but not with the high intake. And non-modifiable risk factors like age. Most of the time, the heart attack is very common after the age of 60 years. And family history, if there is a family history of heart attack, and gender, usually males are more prone for heart attacks as compared to females. Next slide, please. So what tests we can do? See, what happens? If there is any symptom of coronary artery disease, better get a regular testing done to the nearest, come to the nearest hospital and do all these tests like ECG. Normal ECG doesn't mean that there is no blockages inside the heart. But if there is a significant blockage, definitely there will be some kind of a change in the ECG. Next slide, please. Treadmill test. This is another test wherein you will be put with ECG monitors and they ask you to make walk and stress your heart so that your heartbeats go on up and up. At the same time, we'll see the changes in the ECG. If there is any change in the ECG, can be identified. Next slide, please. And echocardiogram. Echocardiogram is just like an ultrasound where we do a probing of the chest and see the beating of the heart, heart muscle contractions, wall motion abnormalities, any leakage in the valve and pressure in the pulmonary arteries and the coronary arteries. And next is the gold standard test is coronary angiogram. Angiogram is the gold standard test. If we have any doubt that there is some blockage in the coronary arteries and there is reduced blood supply to the heart, this is the gold standard. Coronary angiogram is the test which is going to be done. And it shows clearly if there is any blockage. You can see there is a very critical narrowing of the coronary artery, which will reduce the blood supply to the heart. And there are some other tests like CT coronary angiogram, which may not be a gold standard, but they will pick up some kind of a calcium deposit in the coronary arteries. Next slide, please. This is the CT coronary angiogram. It will show any narrowing or calcium deposition in the coronary artery. Next slide, please. So how do you prevent this coronary artery disease? These are the main important points. Regular dieting, controlling the cholesterol, and regular exercise, stopping smoking, use of moderation of alcohol, and reducing the stress. Next slide, please. Coming to the diet, we have to prevent a heart attack, the cardio-healthy diet contains very high fiber and low fat diet. Predominantly, it should be in a vegetarian diet and choose a non-fat or low-fat products. Use lean meats. If you want to take non-vegetarian, use a lean meat or a white meat. Switch to a fat-free milk. Next slide, please. And everybody is interested about to know about this cholesterol. What is this cholesterol? It is a component. This cholesterol is a very important component of the body. So it serves a vital function of the body. It is a very important part of the nervous tissue of the body that is in the brain and spinal cord. Frequently, it is measured to promote the health and prevent disease, especially to boost your immunity. And it is a major component of the plaque or the clog in the artery. Next slide, please. So there are four types of cholesterol: chylomicrons, low density lipoproteins, very low density lipoproteins, and high density lipoproteins. And some of them are good and some of them are bad. Next slide, please. And certain fats are essential for good nutrition and health. And fat provides essential fatty acids which cannot be produced in the body. It has to be taken only by food. And it acts as an insulator to maintain the body temperature. And it improves the digestion as well. Next slide, please. And these are the various levels of different types of cholesterol in the blood. And desirable levels and borderline levels and higher levels. Next slide. Usually we say HDL is a very good cholesterol because it takes out the bad cholesterol from the liver and throws it out of the body. And it, the level should be around 35 to 50. And higher levels of this HDL actually negates the coronary artery disease. Next slide, please. The LDL and the VLDL are the bad cholesterol, which will actually increase the plaquing in the coronary arteries. Next slide, please. What we have to remember is we should make sure that we take around 20 to 35% of the calories from the fat. The remaining should be from the proteins and the carbohydrates. Next slide, please. And coming to this slide, because many people keep asking, which oil to be used. And this chart shows that how much percentage of saturated fatty acids, unsaturated fatty acids, monounsaturated fatty acids, how much oil, how many percentage of each oil contains all these kinds of fatty acids. Usually what we say is saturated fatty acid, which is very rich in triglycerides and low density lipoproteins. So it is very bad to the health. So as you see that palm oil, butter fat, coconut oil and lard and animal fat contains very high percentage of saturated fatty acids as compared to vegetable oils like canola oil, sunflower oil, corn oil or olive oil, which contains high percentage of polyunsaturated fatty acid and monounsaturated fatty acid. So better to use vegetable oils as compared to animal oils. Next slide, please. So what diet therapy we should do for high blood pressure and cholesterol? Try to avoid trans fatty acids, which are usually used in fast foods. Increased LDL and VLDL should not be used. And HDL oil, cholesterol. So some food may contain increased LDL and decreased HDL, which is not good. In turn, you are better to take fat, which is more in HDL and lesser LDL levels. Next slide, please. So intake of trans fatty acids should be as low as possible. Next slide, please. So this shows, So how to treat the coronary heart disease? Control the weight by reducing the weight. Next. Can you keep pressing that? So ideally you should say that, take a diet which is more in fiber, less in saturated fat and more of a proteins and carbohydrates with high fiber. So coming to the drug treatment, sometimes even though you do all this, exercise, diet and all these things, your cholesterol will keep remaining high because of some genetic problems. And this cholesterol will not be reduced in your blood. And so in such conditions, we treat with statins and other medications, which may not be important for you right now. Next slide, please. And as you know that, exercise, regular exercise is very important. Smoking should be stopped. Actually, smoking can cause reduced HDL levels and increased LDL levels. And within 1 year of quitting the smoking, you can the coronary arteries can come back to the normal levels. Next slide, please. So alcohol consumption in moderation is good, but not in higher quantity. In spite of all these things, even still you have a coronary artery disease, there is, next slide please, there is a treatment, you know, like there are medications, angioplasty can be done, coronary artery bypass surgery can be done, and they can lead a normal life. Next slide please. So this is angioplasty stenting, wherein we can see that there is a clogged artery there, and we put a stent and remove those blockages. Next slide please. And this is the coronary artery bypass surgery, wherein new vessels which are harvested either from the chest wall or from the leg, and these vessels are anastomosed to form a bypass circuit, bypassing the blockage there. Next slide please. This is the operation theater, what we do bypass surgery. Next slide please. So in conclusion, it is highest among coronary artery disease, highest among Indians, and it is a preventable disease, and treatment is there for sure. So you don't have to worry at this point of time. Next slide, please. So this presentation is completed now. I will take any questions if you want. I will take any questions and clarify your doubts.
So thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your presentation. We have a few questions from the audience, and meanwhile I have one question, sir. Yeah. You told us continuous exercise is required and body weight also to be maintained. So recently we heard there is a person, he's a CEO of Mercedes-Benz. So he was in fact a continuous runner, and he was every day he used to run for more than 5 kilometer, 10 kilometer, and with all those things, we recently heard a news called he has passed away during the treadmill running. So what would be the reason, even after maintaining all the things, still we go through this sort of heart diseases?
Yeah, it's a good question actually. What happens is when you at the beginning of this program, you said that, you know, heart muscle is like, when you go to the gym and do workouts, the biceps and triceps are going to increase in size and strength. Similarly, if the heart muscle is worked more, it also will increase in size, and which is very bad for the patient, very bad for the heart. Just like, you know, working out in a gym with weights, biceps and triceps increases its bulk. Similarly, heart also can increase its bulk if excessive stress is given. And at that point of time, what happens? There is an outlet for the heart muscle from the heart cavity. The blood goes out through the aorta, and the heart muscle at that area where the blood goes out is called aortic valve. Below the aortic valve, if the heart muscle increases its size, it is called hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is one of the most common cause for sudden cardiac deaths in young athletes. You can say that, you know, a runner, as you said, runner during the treadmill, or while playing football or cricket or any physical activity, this heart muscle increases in size and suddenly it closes off the outlet, so that there will be a sudden cardiac death. Probably that must have happened to this runner. So usually these runners and athletes, tennis players or the football players, can have hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. That can be identified by doing a simple echocardiogram, wherein we have this, we can measure the thickness of the heart muscle. If it is more than certain millimeters, then they are more prone for sudden cardiac deaths, and we can tell them to avoid doing all this excessive physical activity.
Doctor, I'll be reading out the questions from the group. I have noted them in the order. Choose to order, answer them in the same order. The first one was,
is that the chats that I have to open?
Yeah, we will
read reading out. I have already noted down the questions from the chat.
Fine.
So for your convenience, I have made a compilation of it and I'll be reading it out.
Okay.
First question is, what is the function of dorsal aorta?
Dorsal aorta.
Aorta.
Okay. See, the aorta has got four parts, you know, ascending aorta, arch of the aorta, and dorsal aorta, abdominal aorta. So these were the four parts of the aorta. Aorta is nothing but a major artery which comes out from the heart. It is a big pipe which carries an oxygenated blood to the whole part of the body. So as soon as it emerges out, the aorta gives a branch called coronary arteries, which supplies the heart itself, the ascending aorta. The arch of the aorta will supply blood to the neck and the brain and the upper part of the body. And then the dorsal aorta is the aorta which is there in the chest cavity. The aorta which is there in the chest cavity will supply the blood supply to the esophagus, that is adukke anna nada anta heltivi, and the lungs and other parts in the chest. And then the abdominal aorta, which gives branches or oxygenated blood to the intestine and other like liver, kidney, pancreas, etc., etc. So the dorsal aorta is the aorta which is there in the chest part of the body.
Okay, thank you, doctor. The next one is, what is the difference between heart attack and heart failure?
Yeah, if the blood vessel gets clogged and there is no blood supply to the rest of the heart muscle is going to die. That is called heart attack. Once the heart attack happens, the pumping capacity of the heart is reduced. Usually the pumping capacity of the heart is how much it is going to pump out in every contraction or whenever it squeezes. This pumping capacity will get reduced once there is a heart attack, because certain part of the heart muscle will be dead, or they will not be working, or they will not contribute to the pumping capacity of the heart. At that point of time, what happens? The heart muscle contracts very weak or feebly. At that time, the amount of blood which is throwing out or pumping out will reduce. That is called heart failure.
Great. The next one is, angiogram is done without anesthesia. Patients are too scared already. Can this test cause more anxiety? Can this be done without anesthesia?
Okay.
I'll reread it. Angiogram is done without anesthesia. Patients are already too scared.
I got it. Yeah. I got it. The answer is, usually angiogram is an OPD procedure. It can be done in 5 minutes or 7 minutes of time. And it is just a prick kind of a sensation that you get in the either your groin or most of the time in the wrist, that is the radial artery. We just put a thread like a catheter like thing which goes up to the heart and injects certain contrast material and then takes the picture. So it will hardly take 5 minutes. Any 5 minutes procedure without any more of a invasive procedure, you know, need not have to give general anesthesia for that. By giving anesthesia, there are more side effects as compared to keeping the patient awake and finishing off the test. It is just a simple test. No, I'm not hearing.
One second. Hold on. The next one is, how do we manage diastolic dysfunction? How does it occur?
Yeah, as I said, as you put more pressure, you know, physical pressure on the heart muscles will get stiffened or increase in size. When they get stiffened or increase in size, the heart will not relax properly. So as a heart relaxes, the chamber will get filled with blood, and when it contracts, the blood will be pumped out. So to relax the heart muscle should be very pliable. It should not be stiff. If it becomes very stiff, then it becomes diastolic dysfunction. It will not accommodate more blood in the chamber, so that blood cannot be properly pumped out. That is called diastolic dysfunction. And this diastolic dysfunction can be prevented either with medications, or if a person is doing a lot of anaerobic exercises like weightlifters, or those who are doing heavy work, you know, lifting heavy weights and all those kind of people are very commonly affected with diastolic dysfunction. That should not be done. Anaerobic exercises better to avoid. Better to do aerobic exercises which increase the heart rate rather than increasing the muscles volume.
Okay. Thank you, doctor. The next one is, what is an alternate test for angiogram? Is this a good, is this as good as angiogram? What is the option?
There are some alternate tests like CT coronary angiogram. Instead of a conventional angiogram, we can do a CT scan of the heart, but it is not a foolproof method. It will only give the score of calcium deposition, calcium score, but it will not show how much narrow the blood vessel has become. Even though there is a test called coronary CT coronary angiogram, it is not a gold standard.
Okay, thank you. So there is the next one is there any problem in working night shifts? And related to that is, does insomnia cause heart attack?
Yes, there are some studies wherein, you know, a good amount of sleep of 6 to 8 hours will prevent coronary artery disease. So any kind of a physical stress or a mental stress are precursors of this coronary artery disease. So doing a night shift or being awake for a longer time in the night or getting stressed out, mental worries, all those things will definitely increase the incidence of heart attack.
So do you want to suggest anything to tackle insomnia?
See, there are one is they can do yoga, they can do aerobic exercises, they can have counseling with the psychiatrist, and there are certain medications which can be given to treat insomnia.
Great, sir. One other question here has, what is the most common cause of sudden cardiac deaths?
Yeah, as I said, the most common cause is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Usually these muscles, the younger people who are athletes and who run for, you know, hours together can have increased thickness of cardiac muscle. And this hypertrophic cardiomyopathy can cause sudden cardiac death. And the other second most common cause is coronary artery disease, this plaque rupture. What happens is there is a plaque sitting in a coronary artery and the plaque ruptures and the blood flow will be stopped. And once the blood flow is stopped, then the clot will form. The clot, the red blood cells will get deposited and the clot will be formed. And there is complete cutoff of blood supply. Not even a single drop of blood goes down to the myocardium. At that point of time also, sudden cardiac death can happen.
Okay. There's one. Ramesh, can you just put up the slide on the cholesterol levels? People want to see that. And related to that, doctor, is they want to know the comparison of mustard oil with other oils.
Okay.
And also, what are the good suggested exercises for a good heart, for a healthy heart?
Yeah. Coming to the kind of oil that we are going to use, as I said, oil which is rich in polyunsaturated fatty acid and monounsaturated fatty acid is always good. We cannot recommend that only you can use only this oil or that oil. Combination of oils are also good to prepare the food, and make sure that the oil should not be the energy, whatever you are going to spend, the calories, the contribution from this fat or the oil should not be more than 20%. So you can see there in the list, canola oil, sunflower oil, corn oil, olive oil, soya bean oil, peanut oil, and up to cotton seed oil. So all these are vegetable oils are good in polyunsaturated fatty acid and monounsaturated fatty acid. Comparatively, saturated fatty acid are very less. When you go down the graph, the coconut oil contains 91% of saturated fatty acid. Butter or ghee contains 68%. Palm oil, 51%. Lard and beef oil, that is the animal fat oil, they contain around 48 to 50% of the saturated fatty acid. So all these oils, canola oil, sunflower oil, corn oil, olive oil, peanut oil, anything is good. You can use any one of them.
How about coconut oil, sir?
Sorry?
How about coconut oil?
Coconut oil contains more of saturated fatty acid. It may be good for the brain, but it is not good for the heart. Some people advise you can use coconut oil to avoid this Alzheimer's disease or Parkinson's disease. They're all brain-related diseases. It may be good for the brain-related disease, but not good for the heart.
This is of prime concern. A lot of people are asking questions on this. The sleeplessness affect our heart? Is it hereditary for a heart attack, of a heart attack? And what kind of exercise will get us good sleep and avoid heart problems?
Yeah, as I said, definitely sleeplessness can increase the incidence of heart attack. To avoid that, during the daytime, you have to be active. Try to avoid sleeping in the afternoon hours, or have a good kind of aerobic exercise of at least 20 minutes in a day. It may be in the morning or it may be in the evening. Aerobic exercise increases the heart rate, but not increases the heart muscle thickness. So these are the exercises like cycling, jogging, swimming, brisk walking, and this dance, Zumba dance, and other kind of programs will be there, which will increase the heart rate, but not the heart strength of the heart muscle. So this kind of exercise you should choose, like dancing, swimming, cycling, brisk walking, or jogging for 20 minutes. 20 to 30 minutes is okay.
So how do you compare this yoga with other any cardio exercise?
Yoga, in the yoga thing, usually the heart rate will not be increased, but it will calm down the brain. So for example, pranayama is good for the heart. There are different types of yogas for different parts of the body. Certain yogas will give exercise only to the intestine or the liver. Certain yogas will give exercise to the lungs. Certain yogas give exercise to the heart. So you have to choose a heart yogasanas are there. You have to choose that and concentrate on that.
Thank you, sir. The next question, before I go there, Ramesh, can I request you to please pull up the slide on the cholesterol levels while the audience watch it? I have a question. What is the ideal heartbeat per minute? The lower, the better. There's a myth that, you know, the lower the heartbeat, yes, the longer, yes, you live.
Yeah.
So what is it? And second question is, what do you mean by minimal invasive when you say you're minimal?
Cardiac surgery. Okay. So coming to the heartbeats, the heartbeat is usually better to keep between 60 and 80 per minute. So lower the heartbeat, what happens? The blood flow happens during the diastole, in between the beats. For example, if a person is having a heartbeat of 60, the in between beat, the gap is there. During that gap, the blood flows inside the coronary arteries. The blood flow is better in between the beats. So if the beats are lesser, the gap between the beats are more. When there is a gap in between the beats are more, the blood flow will be better. That's why they say lower the heartbeat, it is better for the heart. So better to keep this beat between 60 and 80. Usually athletes and those who do aerobic exercise will have a lesser heartbeat as compared to a person who is sedentary and who is smoking and drinking coffee and consuming more of alcohol. All these things will increase the heartbeat.
Thank you, sir. I think any more questions? I mean, we had a very enriching session.
Yeah, we have, I think, the below all questions completed.
Yeah, these are the cholesterol levels. You don't have to bother about the readings. Usually what we do is high risk patients with very high cholesterol, we usually advise dietary modification and exercise first, which will reduce these cholesterols. Even with dietary modification exercise, the readings are going to be high, then only we are going to start medications.
Sir, I think you missed explaining us the minimal invasive.
Okay. Coming to minimal invasive heart surgery, as the technology grew, even our expertise in doing surgeries with a very small incision has improved. So initially we used to cut the the chest and crack the chest open right from, you know, from top to down, and there used to be a big scar there, and especially diabetics who are more prone for these you know kind of infection can have the wound infection and bone infection, and we may need a longer time for healing, and so problems were there. So now we started doing most of the surgeries through in between the ribs, without in between ribs, without cutting the bone, without cutting the bone. So we have special instrumentation and expertise for that. What we do is take a small incision in between the ribs without cutting the bone and reach the heart and do operation. That is called minimally invasive cardiac surgery.
Okay. And I have following. How do I keep the heartbeat low? And how about drinking coffee and tea? Is it okay and bad?
Yeah, I told you already about this in the last question. Drinking coffee and tea, excessive drinking coffee and tea will increase the heart rate. Better to avoid. Twice or thrice a day is okay. Some people will take 10 times, 12 cups, 15 cups like that. Mm-hmm. Those people will definitely have increased heart rate. Sometimes they will have ectopic heartbeats. You know, they can feel a missed beat in their, you know, when they are doing an activity. So if that is the situation, then they have to drastically, immediately stop drinking this coffee and tea. Definitely it will increase the heart rate and can cause some arrhythmias, like a missed heartbeat or kind of irregular heartbeat. And coming to reducing the heart rate, doing an aerobic exercise, doing pranayama will definitely reduce the heart rate.
I think that's it from the question session.
Yeah, sir. We have many runners here. So do you have any tips for the runners? In fact, we organize one run called Pride Run every year, annually on the same platform. So do you have any tips for the runners for their related to heart?
The usually, you know, the runners, they will be knowing that they have to have a medical health check before going for a long runs. They have to have a health check, they have to have a normal blood pressure, they have to have a regular heartbeat, and they have to have normal blood pressure. If they are sedentary and they are not runners from the beginning without getting any training, running for long distance at once is not at all recommended. They have to get the training. They cannot just run 5 kilometers in a single day. They have to have slow and regular training for that. And if they have any other health issues like diabetes or hypertension or on any medications, they cannot run for longer distances. They have to restrict.
Thanks, sir.
Thanks. So any other questions?
I think that's the questions. So thank you very much. And friends who are participating in this, we also have a e-certificate issued for all the participants. Please do collect the e-certificate. Okay, I request Dr. Bridge to give his closing remarks and what up. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's a wonderful session which we have been having close to 50 participants today. Thanks to Dr. Ashwini, who has been so effective covering all the, you know, day-to-day practice or exercise, and it's preventable most of the cases where any of the human being can control many of those heart ailments with help of whether diet control, exercise, and also taking care of simple stuff like blood pressure. And also he has given very deep insights on the ingredients, what are things to be selected and what are not to be, including for saturated fatty acids, rich food, whether it's coconut oil or any of the animal fat driven things, and also soluble fiber, vitamin B3, bile acid, the therapy, of course, the statins, or any of those treatments required for insomnia, Those things are covered so well, and I think hope all participants they could enjoy this session, you know, one-on-one online, being hosted by both Rotary Artinagar and Rotary Yalahanka. So many of the Rotarians, district representatives, presidents and past president and AZs are here. So thanks to everyone to ensure that it has been a very rich experience for all the participants, of course, along with our speaker, Dr. Ashwini. So once again, I really appreciate on behalf of all the organizers, and thank you, Dr. Ashwini.
Thank you very much. And this session will be recorded and will be available in the YouTube for anybody who wants, who can watch in that, we'll circulate and also post your comments on this session. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Ashwini Prasad.
Thank you. Thank you. Good day.